In this video, we're going to discuss some of the questions about ethics and equity that might be useful to consider when doing educational data mining. So, educational data can include very sensitive information just by its nature, and some of the decisions that we make from the analysis of this data can have long-term impact on students. And for this reason, it's really important to consider ethics and equity when we're working with educational data. So in this video, I'm going to discuss ethics and equity, but I'm not going to give answer. I'm mostly going to be raising questions that I think is important to consider if you're working with educational data. So in terms of ethics, right? So the usage of computers in education just keeps increasing and increasing. And so we have a lot of data, digital data about the educational context that's also increasing. So it's important to ask ourselves ethical questions when we're going to be using this data. And one of the first questions we should be asking ourselves is about privacy. So depending on the data that you're using, the type of data that you're using, how you're using it, privacy might be more or less of an issue. But usually what we want is to make the data as anonymous as possible. But to what extent can we actually anonymize the data we have? So if we're working with log files of students' interaction with a digital learning environment, that might not be too much of an issue. Log files of interactions are relatively low-stake data. It's just traces of how the student is using the learning environment. And it's relatively easy to anonymize because we don't really need the name of the student. We don't have any type of really identifying information. But sometimes we want to study that in the context of additional information, such as the socioeconomical status of the student, the gender, the race, the learning outcomes, and that information can be sensitive. And the more information we add, the less anonymous the data becomes, right? If we have information about gender, race, age, where the data was collected, then we might be actually, even if we don't have the name of the student, we might still be able to narrow down a very small subset of possible students for that data, right? So we need to be careful, especially that information might be very useful for research purposes. So we need to ask ourselves the question, do we really need that data? If we don't collect that data, how is that going to affect our analysis? And try to be careful to only collect the data that we actually want and try to be careful in how we handle it. We can also think about institutional data, for example, detailed grades report, disciplinary interventions report. Who should have access to that data? What are the implications of sharing this data, especially if it's possible to de-anonymize it? There are also some types of data that we just simply cannot anonymize. For example, if we were studying webcam feeds because we want to look at the facial expression of a student as they are using a digital learning environment, if we wanted to make that data anonymous, then we would be required to make sure that the faces are not visible. But then if we remove the faces, then we can't look at the facial expression, and the utility of the data becomes far less. So we need to be careful on how we store that data, make sure that only the persons that should have access to that data actually do. A second question that we might be asking ourselves is whether or not we should be informing the student about what data we're collecting and how that data is going to be used. And this is true in education as it's true in different aspects of our life. If we think about social network online like Facebook, or if we think about all the data that's collected from Google, we can ask ourselves the question, should we be informed of the data that's being collected and how it's going to be used? But if we do inform the student of what data we're collecting, a follow-up question is, will that affect how students interact with the learning environment? So maybe if students know that we're monitoring whether or not they're disengaged from the learning environment, they're going to find ways to trick the environment into thinking that they're not disengaged. So when we're conducting research, usually there is some form of consent that must be given for the collection of data. But what about usage of data outside of the research context in the regular classroom, right? So should the student consent to the collection of data in that context? Should we give the option to the student to opt out of this data collection? And if we do give the option to opt out, is that going to affect the learning experience that the student have? So if the student, if we can't collect data and we can't apply all our models of student behavior and we can't drive automatic intervention using those models, then the student might not get as much out of the learning environment than someone else that did not opt out. Another thing to consider is data ownership. So who owns the data that we're collecting? In the case of institutional data, does the institution owns the data? What does that mean? Can they share it with other people, or do they have to keep it to themselves? In the case of learning environment, does the creator of the learning environment owns the data? And if they do, what can they do with it? There's also people that are advocating for the possibility of having the student own their own data. So if the student owns their data, they have control over who has access to that data and what can be done with it. Now, in terms of equity, there's also some very important considerations here. So one of them is, how do we ensure that models that we develop and the results that we obtain from our analysis are valid for every student and not just a subset of the students? And a second question is, how do we use those models and the results from those models in a sensible way? So in terms of how do we ensure that the models are valid for every student, well, one of the things that happens is that when we use educational data mining to build models, because data collection can be very difficult and very expensive, we tend to validate our model on specific data sets. And even though we take steps to make sure that those models are as general as possible, it's still possible that it's still very difficult to really assess how general the model is going to be when it's going to be applied to a new data set. For example, Okumpa and colleagues in 2014 studied the accuracy of a model that they built to detect affect in an intelligent tutoring system. So for example, detecting whether a student is confused, or a student is bored, or a student is frustrated. And in this study, what they realized is that the models that they built were not equally good across different data sets collected from three different schools. So if the model was built using data from one school, it might not be as effective when applied to data from a second school. So how do we make sure that the models that we build, when we apply them to new data set, they're actually going to be working well? And then even if we're not applying the models to a new data set, we should still ask ourselves, is the model equally good across all the students within one data set? Is there any biases for specific students? What kind of biases do we have? For example, if we think about facial recognition, we can probably think that facial recognition, if we train our model using data from only female students, then it's likely that it's not going to generalize that well if we apply it to male students. And so for different type of model, there might be different biases that we need to make sure that we account for when we build our model. And this is a very important thing to consider when building models. Now, once we have our model, we need to figure out what is a sensible way to use those models. So when we build a model, usually the model that we get are not 100% accurate. So we know that there's some room for errors in our model. So how can we use the models, knowing that there's going to be error, to improve the learning experience of every student? So let's say that we have a model that's able to detect student who game the system, which is a form of disengaged behavior in which the student is trying to solve problem without actually having to learn anything by abusing the support offered by the learning environment. Let's say that we have this model and it works at about 50% above chance for detecting gaming behavior, which is actually pretty good for a model of gaming behaviors. Then can we use this model to automatically provide interventions when gaming behavior is detected? So one of the way we might approach this problem is, say, maybe we can wait for multiple gaming behavior before we start providing interventions. So that would reduce the chance that we're going to give an intervention on a false positive where the student is not gaming, but we still detect the student as gaming. We can also have the opposite, where what about if we have false negatives, which means that we don't detect gaming when the student is gaming. So again, we might be missing some instances of gaming, and maybe that's not too bad if we're able to detect other instances of gaming for that specific student, we're still going to be giving an intervention, right? Another approach is to change the strength of the intervention based on different factors, like how often did we detect the student as gaming, or how confident the model is that the student is gaming. But then all of those considerations, they assume that the model detects gaming behavior equally well for every student. What would happen if our model actually has a bias in its detection of gaming behavior? Maybe some students might always be identified as gaming even though they aren't. And then what will happen is that the students, for those students, the learning environment is going to intervene more often, which is going to take some time away from the student to actually engage in meaningful way with the learning environment. And that might also lead the student to develop negative affect towards the learning environment and disengage. And we can also have the opposite situation where some students might never be detected as gaming the system, even though they are. And what will happen now is that they will never receive those additional interventions that they would benefit from. The teachers won't know. They won't be notified that the student is gaming, so they won't be able to intervene. And the student, because of that, might fall behind their classmate and have difficulties catching up later on. So this is in the context of gaming behavior, which is actually a relatively low-stake construct, which means that it might not be that much of an issue if the model is somewhat biased. But what happens if we apply this to a higher-stake construct? For example, if we consider a model that's going to be predicting college enrollment from student interaction within an intelligent tutoring system, right? So this model can provide us with some really useful information that allow us to study what leads students to enroll in college or not, but how actionable is it, right? So what would the intervention that we would do based on this model look like, and how would we determine which student received those intervention? Is the model used in addition to the current interventions, or does it replace it? And if we replace the current intervention with the model, what is the impact of intervening for a student who doesn't need it? And what is the impact of not intervening for a student who needs it? We might be penalizing students based on a model that's not accurate for them. So if the model has strong biases on a subpopulation of student, then we might have very strong impact in the future on the enrollment of student, the enrollment in college of that subpopulation of students. And so just to quickly conclude, so we've looked at some of the questions of ethics and equity with educational data. So educational data can be very sensitive depending on its content, so it's very important to ask ourselves those questions. Unfortunately, there's not always an obvious right or wrong answer to those questions, and it's kind of contextual depending on what you're doing, what kind of data you're working with, how you're going to use the result of those analysis. But hopefully this video is going to be able to provide you with some information that in the future, if you're working with educational data, you can think back and ask yourself those questions and make the right decision for your work.